If you have your bulletins there, you'll see in our message is going to be in Matthew chapter 24, verses 37 through, I put 42 there. We're going to go through 44. And a lot of people, they say, you know, Brother Byron, why do you put your messages in the bulletin? I thought you're supposed to wait on the leadership of the Holy Spirit before you preach. And while that is true, the leadership of the Holy Spirit can hit you through the week as well as on Sunday morning. I don't like to wait around and be surprised in the mornings. But if you follow the Lord's leadership and you pray and you ask Him for a message, He'll lay something on your heart early. It doesn't have to wait until 2 minutes before you get behind the pulpit. So that's why I put them in there, because I like to be prepared. I like people to know where we're at. And you can also take that home and reference back to Scripture. And if you want to, somebody ask you what your preacher preached today, you can pull out your bulletin and say, it's right here. We preached this right here. But Matthew chapter 24, starting verse 37. These are the words of Jesus. And He says here in verse 37, "But as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day that Noah entered into the ark, and knew not until the flood came and took them all away, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. Then shall two be in the field, the one shall be taken, the other left. Two women shall be grinding at the mill, the one shall be taken, the other left. Watch therefore, for ye know not what hour your Lord doth come. But know this, that if the good man of the house had known what watch the thief would come, he would have watched, and would not have suffered his house to be broken up. Therefore be ye also ready, for in such an hour as ye think not, the Son of Man cometh." Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, thank you so much again for this opportunity to stand behind the pulpit, to open up the bread of life, God, and just try to do a little bit of good, Lord, today. Lord, we need your help. We need you to preach for us. Lord, you know that we can't do it on our own and never intend to. God, we need your leadership, your Holy Spirit, your guidance. God, open our minds and hearts to receive this word. Keep us out of the flesh this morning, Lord, and in your word, so that we'll be able to understand it, Lord, and take it home with us and take it to other places, Lord, and tell others about you. And Lord, we just need your Spirit this morning. These things we ask in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, you know, all for the last few weeks, well, actually, ever since all this, all these elections and all these things that's been going on, and all these things in the news, the Chick-fil-A controversy, and everything that we see going on in the world today, and it can't help but depress you. It can't help but get you down. If you're a Christian, you can't help but be affected by the things that's going on in this disgusting, wicked world that we live in. And, you know, I'm looking for that day. You know, a lot of us talk about how we long to go to heaven, how we just wish we could go to heaven, but we try our dead level best not to die, because we don't want to die that soon. But we long for that place called heaven, because it's not going to be like this place down here. It's not going to be this wickedness and this evil that goes on all the time down here. You know, I think about the end of all the mess, the end of the trials, the end of cancer, the end of the sodomites trying to take over, the end of the abortionists and the abortion clinics. And praise God, we lost one of those abortion clinics in Knoxville this past week. They couldn't survive, and it was closed down. I thank the Lord for that. I thank you for that. But I look at all this stuff and I think about the end of persecution, the end of strife, the end of Christians being laughed at and mocked, and the end of the Bible being made such fun of and lied of. I look for the end. I look for the end of it. As we preach today, I want you to face this with an urgent sincerity. And think about this. If you're a Christian today, I want you to think about this with the heart of a Christian. And what God's trying to tell us in here through His Son, Jesus, as He wrote it. He spoke these words. I'd love to give everybody in here a sugary, sweet sermon this morning. I'd like to get out some peppermint sticks and just make it so sweet. You leave in here just feeling like you've been sitting on a marshmallow cloud and everything's just great in the world. I'd love to be able to do that. Not today. It's not today. It's not the message the Lord's gave me today. It's not a sugary, sweet coated man. It's a hard message today to preach, and it's a hard message to hear. And it's from the truth. It's from God's Word. It's not my opinion. It's God's. It's what He says. In verse 37 there, He said, "But as the days of Noah were," that's spelled there in our King James, N-O-E. That is the Greek spelling of the name Noah. So don't let that throw you off. It's Noah who we're talking about. The eighth preacher, the one of righteousness, the one that was saved in the flood, the one that built the ark, is that Noah. And we touched briefly on this last week. We were preaching that message about people having no time for God. We talked about this a little bit. But Jesus goes on to add, after He says, "But as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be." The Son of Man. Who's the Son of Man? People say, "Well, who is the Son of Man?" Well, Jesus Himself refers to Himself as that 80 times in your Bible. He's the Son of Man. And we see other titles that He's given. Perhaps the Son of David. That'd been his Jewish name. Maybe the Son of God. That's His divine and holy name. But here He's the Son of Man. What's that? That's His, you might call it His mission name or His racial name. The name that He uses to call Himself because He represents all of man. He's the Savior of men. And so He calls Himself what? The Son of Man. And that says right here, "So shall also the coming of the Son of Man be." Now if you're saved this morning, then you should have no problem with this. If you're saved, you should delight in the thought that the Son of Man is going to return one day, and you don't have a clue of when it's going to be. You should be delighted in that thought that when He does come, that you're going to be going on to be with Him. Now you may die before He comes. You may go on in death and meet Him there. But if you don't, if He tarries His coming long enough to where He comes before you go, then you're going to go with Him if you're a child of God. If you're a Christian this morning, this ought to bring you joy and comfort. But if you're not, if you've not been saved today, if you don't know the Lord Jesus as your personal Savior, this message right here, this Scripture, ought to reach out and grab you by the throat and just give you for all you've got. You should be shaking in your shoes this morning if you don't know the Son of God. If you don't know the Son of Man. If you don't know the Son of David. If you don't know Him. If you've not accepted Him, this should scare you to death. We look at this in verse 38. He lists several things that was going on in these days of Noah. He says they were eating. They were drinking. They were marrying and giving in marriage. Just the list of everyday activities. Doesn't sound so bad, does it? Just normal, everyday, mundane things of life that we all do every day. There's nothing wrong with any of those things. There's not a thing wrong with any of that. Why do you list those things that people were doing back in those days of Noah? Well, I'm going to tell you why. As He lists these things, and we know what happened in those days of Noah. We're going to talk about this more in a minute. As He lists all these things that they were doing, He's trying to get a picture in your mind of a people that thought nothing except of themselves. They cared not about anything that had to do with the things of God. Touching on the things of God, they cared not. But what did they care about? They cared about eating. They cared about marrying, drinking, eating, all these things. They cared about that. Why? Because that was them. That pertained to them. That's me. That's my little space right here. Don't you invade my little space right here, because I'm going to make sure that I'm taken care of. Don't we all have that sense of self-preservation, that we want to take care of ourselves? What He's trying to get in our mind this morning is a people, a whole race of people, a world of people that had no thought on their mind of anything else except themselves. That's all they thought about. Sounds a lot like today, doesn't it? Sounds a whole lot like today. It says, "Now, in the days of Noah, God looked down." We talked about this last Sunday. Over in Genesis chapter 6 and verse 5, if you want to turn there with me. God looks down upon man. And He sees that they're living out their mundane lives, eating and drinking, marrying, giving in marriage, and all these things, and living out that life. But He saw something else there. Not only did they care nothing except themselves, He looked down, and in Genesis chapter 6 and verse 5, it says, this awful assessment of man by God is given. It says, "And God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually." And it repented the Lord that he had made man on the earth. And it grieved him at his heart. And the Lord said, I'll destroy man whom I've created from the face of the earth. Both man and beast, the creeping things, the fowls of the air. For it repenteth me that I have made them. These are some strong words given by God. Very strong words given. He said it grieved him at his heart. And it repenteth him that he maketh man. These are strong words from God. And I've heard people try to pass this off as, oh man, that's not what he meant. He didn't mean that. He didn't really mean that he was sorry he made man. He didn't really repent of making man. He wasn't grieved in his heart. Friends, the Bible says what it means, and it means what it says. And you can look at any kind of Greek lexicon. You can look at any Greek word study, any kind of study you want to do. You look at these words right here, and they mean exactly what we think they mean. We're not trying to explain away God today. We can't explain away His Word, because His Word is the truth, and it's the power that lies within these words. It is the truth, and it means what it says. What does it say? It said that it grieved Him at His heart. This word grieve means to worry, to pain, to anger, to be displeased, to hurt, to make, to be sorry, to vex. That's what it means. That's what it means when it grieved Him. The same as it means to you when you grieve over something. You can't stand it. It hurts. And God looked down upon man and their wickedness and their evil ways, and it grieved Him in His heart. And then it said it repented Him that He made man. That He made man. This word repent simply means that He was sorry He ever made man. Oh, Brother Byron, God, He's sovereign. He don't have to be sorry. No, He don't have to be sorry about anything. But the Bible said right there He was sorry He ever made man. Why? Because they were wicked. They were full of evil. They did everything in their wicked, evil hearts that they wanted to do. And that's all they did. They cared nothing for Him. He said, I'm just going to wipe them out. I'm going to wipe them out. You know, people don't want to hear this today, but this is the truth. God looks down upon this place, and He cannot be pleased. You can't lead me to believe that the God of heaven, the same God that grieved in His heart when He looked down upon the evilness at that time, that He can look down upon this place right here, right now, Knoxville, Tennessee, and look down upon the people that live in this place and the things they're doing, the things they're thinking, and the things that they're carrying out in their lives. You cannot make me believe that He's not grieved as He looks down and sees it. Of course He's grieved. Of course, this man that He made in the likeness of His own image cares not for him as He looks down upon us. You hear me well this morning. You're going to meet Him face to face one day. Whether it's when He comes back on a cloud of glory, or whether you meet Him in death, you're going to meet Him. You're going to meet Him. There's going to be a day that He's going to finally have enough of the wickedness and the evil that goes on in this place. Enough. And just as in the days of Noah, the Son of Man is going to return, and nobody's going to be ready. They're not going to be ready. Verse 38 says, for as in the days that were before the flood, they were eating, drinking, marrying, giving in marriage, until the day that Noah entered into the ark. And we know that Noah was a preacher of righteousness. Over in 2 Peter, Peter says that he was the preacher of righteousness. So therefore, it leads me to believe that Noah was a preacher, because the Bible said he was a preacher. What do you think the preacher was doing while he was building the ark? You think maybe on his lunch break he was preaching? Maybe in between slinging the hammer and putting the nails in. Maybe he was preaching. Maybe as all those people walked by, as I talked about Sundays, they walked by, no doubt they were walking by shaking their heads and clicking their tongues and all that crazy Noah. Look at him in there. All these years been in there hammering and going on. He's crazy. No doubt they did that. No doubt they do that today as they drive by Highland Baptist Church and they shake their heads and they click their tongues. Look at those people in there in that church. Oh, don't they know what they're... They don't have a clue what they're doing in there. Going in there worshiping somebody they've never seen. Somebody they couldn't see with their own eyes. They're going in there and worshiping. I heard somebody call Jesus a sky wizard. Friends, that offends me.
That offends me. He's not a sky wizard. He's the Son of God. He's the Son of Man. He's Christ the Lord. He's our Savior. He's the one that died for us. That's why we worship Him. And just like in those days of Noah, they didn't believe. Until, the Bible says, until Noah entered the ark. I can see it all those years, what, 120 years? As he worked on that ark, as it got bigger and bigger as they walked by, no doubt they had it. It was just a show to them. As they stood there and watched, made fun of, laughed, mocked, scorned, ridiculed, went home, sat around the table, laughed about it. No doubt people do that to Christians today. As they sit around over here in the restaurant right now. There's probably a restaurant right over here packed right now. People all in it. Well, I'm glad we don't go down there and worship that church. Those people worshiping like that. Just like in the days of Noah, they do the same thing today. They're not going to expect it. And in those days of Noah, as they sit around and make fun, I can see it all falling out, taking place. Perhaps they were out in the yard and they were enjoying a little game of something, maybe like football or soccer or whatever they did back in that day as they were playing. And suddenly the raindrops start falling from the sky. Can you imagine that? As they looked, they had no idea what this was. It's water that's falling from the sky. Honey, what is this right here? Have you ever seen anything like this? Go get your mom in the kitchen. She needs to see this. As they look and they see water falling out of the sky. They're probably going around thinking, well, this is pretty neat. And then they start worrying as that water starts getting higher around their ankles. As they're out there in their backyard, and all of a sudden the backyard starts filling full of water. We've never seen this before. I don't know what's going on here. I've never seen this before. Honey, you better get out of here. I can see the wife as she looks out the window and says, I can't come out there. The house is getting full of water now. There's water all in this house. We got to do something. Put something up here and get the water out. As they all start looking around, what are we going to do? And then they remember that man, that crazy man, Noah. Let's go down there to Noah and find out if this is what he's talking about. Let's go find out. Now, the Bible doesn't go into detail about any of this. It doesn't say that the people did all this. But you think right back here, God gave you a brain to think this morning. And don't you think for a minute that when that started happening, those people, they wanted to find a remedy for the problem that they were having? They wanted to find a solution for what's going on. I can see them as they go over to that ark. So they come up to the ark, and they got the kids, and they're walking around with them, trying to keep them out of the water. Noah, hey, is this rain? Is that what you've been talking about, this stuff? Falling out of the sky, is this what you've been talking about? Hey, Noah. Hey, let me in. I'm ready to come in now. I know you said I'd come in last week. But Noah. Hey! No, this ain't funny. Open the door. My kids are out here. There's water everywhere. It's coming up over their ankles. It's coming up over their knees. I got to get in here. What's going on? Because those people stood there to beat on that door. That door would not open. Once that door closed, it did not open for anybody. They had their chance. Noah preached it for 120 years that people would repent and come to the knowledge of God. And what they do? They did not do it. There was nobody saved on the face of the earth except Noah and seven other people in his family. That was the only people who were saved. Eight people in the entire world. The rest of them perished because they didn't know what happened until the ark closed. The Bible says until Noah entered the ark. Verse 39, and knew not until the flood came and took them all away. So shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. The Bible says there in verse 39, just like in the days of Noah, they didn't have a clue until the flood came. Took them all away. Friends, we've got a world today of clueless people. Those people in that day were clueless. They were going about their everyday mundane lives, just like we do. Clueless. It didn't matter what the preacher said. They remained clueless. Remained that way. One day, God's going to look down upon this place. And He's finally going to have enough. And I know you've been hearing it preached all your life. You know, some people say, well, I don't like hard preaching. You know what? It may not be the hard preaching that bothers people. It may be the hardness of their heart that's bothering them. Because once the Word enters in your heart, that Holy Spirit starts getting you under conviction, you're going to do one of two things, and I've talked about this before. You're either going to run to Him, or you're going to run away from Him. That's your choices. You're going to run to Him, or you're going to run from Him. Friends, there's going to be a day when people are not going to expect it, and it's going to come, just like in the days of Noah. I'm not preaching this morning because I'm delighted in the thoughts of men being destroyed. I don't delight in the thought of people dying and going to hell. I don't take pleasure in that or joy. I know some people do. Some people like to preach it about, oh, you're going to go to hell and burn. And that's true. You are going to if you don't get saved. But I want to tell you why I don't relish in the thought. I don't delight in the thought of people dying and going to hell. I feel sorry for them. I feel burdened for them. No doubt the people that I have to come over here and run off from the church property that like to go and drink and smoke dope behind the church, those people I have to run off, I don't enjoy that. I have a burden for them because I know if they don't come to Christ, they're going to burn and they're going to go to hell. Those people run around here who's never been saved, they're going to die one day and they're going to go to hell. And I'm not going to be happy about it. Nobody's going to be happy about it. Christ isn't happy about it. It's His will that no men perish. That's His will, but they're going to. 1 Corinthians 1:18 says, "For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness. But unto us which are saved is the power of God." So yeah, we're not going to make many friends by preaching from the Bible. We're not going to make many friends preaching the truth from God's Word and telling them straight up that you have to repent of your sins. You have to be saved in order to go to heaven, or you're going to die and go to hell. And that's not going to carry over good in the world like we live in today. It didn't carry over good in Noah's day, let alone today. So yes, the preacher of the cross, to them that's going to perish, is foolishness. They're going to laugh at us. But there's going to be a day, that all that laughter is going to stop. Now, if the Lord decides to come back, and we hear that trumpet sound, and He comes down that cloud of glory, and all those that's been saved, and all those bodies in the ground that's been saved, come up out of that ground, people right then are going to pay attention. It's going to be like in the days of Noah. They didn't have a clue until the door shut. They didn't have a clue until the Lord came down on a cloud of glory. They didn't have a clue. But you know what? By that time, it's too late. All the praying that you can do, all the screaming and crying and begging that you can do is not going to help you. It's over. It's over. You had your chance. It's over. Just like in the days of Noah. When that door shut, your chances are over. Yeah, that pastor down at Highland, he preaches on hell too much. He preaches too hard. He preaches about all that stuff. I want to go in and hear something friendly. I want to go in and hear something for me, something that will lift me up, something that will give me a better job, something that will help my family, something that will give me better finances. I want to hear something positive today. I don't want to go down there and hear that preacher at Highland preach about hell and about the saving grace and the blood of Jesus. I don't want to hear about blood. I want to go down and hear something nice, something sweet. Buster, I want to tell you right now, if you want to hear that, there's all kinds of places to preach that. There's all kinds of places that don't preach the Bible. We preach the Bible here. And I tell you what I'm afraid of. My biggest fear in this life is that when I die and I stand before the righteous judge and I answer for those things, both good and bad, that I did within my body, when I stand before Him and I answer, my biggest fear is He's going to say, "Brother Byron, you did not preach on hell enough. You didn't warn people enough." And I fear that He's going to pull out a list and it's going to have people's names on it. He said, "These people sit on your church pews on Sunday and they left there feeling good about themselves and they never repented and they never felt the need to repent and they walked out of that church feeling good and you didn't tell them about hell. You didn't tell them that they needed to repent and come to the knowledge and the saving grace of the Lord Jesus and now they perish in hell." That's my fear. And I fear God more than I fear men any day of the week. Any day of the week. That's my fear. So yeah, this little fat, short preacher is going to stand behind the pulpit until the day he dies, preaching hell, preaching repentance, preaching Christ and him crucified. And if there ever comes a day that I don't preach that, that's the day I'm going to lay down this King James Bible. I'm going to turn back in my ordination papers that you all gave me as I knelt right here. And I had all those men lay hands on me. And they said, they gave me that charge, just like in old 2 Timothy. Preach the word, be instant in season and out of season. Why? Because on these days, people are not going to listen to it. If that day ever comes that I don't preach the truth, that I don't preach doctrine, that I don't preach Christ and Him crucified, that I don't preach that it takes men to repent and men to come to the knowledge of their sins and come to the knowledge of Christ to be saved, that is the day I will walk out those doors and I'll never come back. That'll be that day. But until then, we have to preach the Word. The day we turn our back on the Word is the day that we will be condemned. God will not allow that to go on forever. There will be a day. We've got to look at verses 40 through 44 all together real quick. We'll be done. Here, Jesus goes on to say, then shall two be in the field, the one shall be taken, the other left. Two women shall be grinding at the mill, the one shall be taken, the other left. Watch therefore, for you know not what hour your Lord has come. But know this, that if the good man of the house had known in what watch the thief would come, he would have watched and would not have suffered his house to be broken up. Therefore, be you also ready, for in such an hour as you think not the Son of Man cometh. Did you see that? This is a haunting picture. This is a terrible, horrible picture of a man whose house has been broken up because they were not ready. They had, no doubt, every opportunity to know the truth. But yet they did not know the truth. They were not ready. I believe that the Bible says exactly what it means here. That there's going to be a time when there'll be one right beside the other. One's going to be taken. The other will not. Because he never come to the knowledge of the truth. Either he resisted it or whatever he did. He doesn't know the Lord. This awful picture of this good man, he wasn't watching after his house. Can you imagine having your family in your home, those that you love the most, admit it, your family, you love your family more than anything else. You would do anything for them. Can you imagine having your family in your home on that great and terrible day when the Lord returns and half of them did not know the Lord? Friend, you've not done your job if that happens. You've not done your job if they don't know. It is our job to warn. It's our job to tell them. We are the ones that's going to be held accountable for that if we don't tell them. If the good man had known, he would have watched and not have his house broken up. But he did not watch. He was caught off guard. His family, maybe his wife, his children, they were not prepared because he didn't prepare them. You've got family members. You've got friends. You've got co-workers. You've got acquaintances. You've got people all around you. What are you doing to warn them about this day? You know, when that day happens, all these people that's rejected it all these years, all these people that had the chance to come to these doors as they drove by our church and laughed, on that great and terrible day, they're going to want to get in this church. They're going to want to come in and hear what the little preacher was saying out of the black book. They're going to be very interested in what went on right here in Highland Baptist Church. They're going to be very, very interested to know. But sadly, it will be too late for them. They will beat on those doors trying to get in here on that last day. The Lord returns and everybody they know and love is gone with them. They will beat on every church door to try to get in the place, to find something about God. They'll try their best to come to the knowledge of Christ, but it will be too late. Too late. Friends, are we going to be guilty on that day that we didn't tell them? Because that day will come.
Perhaps that day will come for many when they close their eyes in death, as they appear in front of the Lord Jesus, and he didn't have a clue who they were. Those that pretended to be saved, he's going to say, "I'm sorry, I never knew you. Depart from me." Those that were never saved, rejected Christ, they're bound for devil's hell. That's just the truth of God's word. Are we doing everything we can? Are we doing it? Brother Byron, and you're the preacher. That's your job. I'm just supposed to come in and pray. That's your job, is to tell people. No, friend. That's not just my job. It's your job. That's all of our jobs. We're all in this together. It's all of our jobs to warn and to tell people. So they'll know, of course, too much. Charlie, if you'll come and play the piano. I'll give an invitation this morning. If you have a need, whether it's a need for salvation, maybe it's a backslidden condition, maybe you need to get closer to him, maybe you need to come and ask him what it is that he would have you do. Whatever it may be, if you'll stand this morning as she plays, let's bow our head and close our eyes. As we pray, if you have a need, I'm going to ask you to come to the altar and let me pray with you. Don't be embarrassed. The day you'll be embarrassed is when you stand before the Lord and you didn't do what you should have done. So if there's a need this morning, you come down as we pray. Father, we're asking you today, God, to help those, Lord, that need strength. Lord, those that need guidance, Lord, those that need you. Lord, those that need the Holy Spirit, God, those that need an urging and a help from you, God, may you convict their hearts, Lord, and have them come down, God, so that we can pray with them, Lord.